gaan we verder met de ideale situatie. Even kijken hoor.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Recently, an article was published in the Volkskrant, a Dutch newspaper, about heroes in our society. The article mentioned people who gave their lives for others. Psychologists had done research on 400 people to find out how people became heroes. What became clear was that there were many similarities in upbringing. Most heroes came from so-called talk families. When, as a child, they did something wrong, their parents would explain to them the effect of their behavior on others and how things could have been done better. Furthermore, it became clear that the later heroes were brought up in an environment with people of different ethnicities, religion and class, and their parents were often involved in voluntary work within the community. Those circumstances made sure that the children at a young age related with the bigger community and felt responsibility in regard to this community. This survey that was published in the Volkskrant exactly shows the content of this lecture. That is to say, how the young child discovers his world and his conscience. It is a beautiful example of education aimed at waking up the compassion in the young child. Bauke has shown us that a harmonious atmosphere is a fertile breeding ground for the young child to rediscover and to awaken its consciousness. In this lecture, we shall talk about the period in which the young child will discover itself, its true character, the reincarnating part. Its consciousness extends also and discovers a bigger world. The external side of the world is its working ground in which it will experience that there is a dichotomy in its character, good Tommy and not so good Tommy. Because of this, he can learn to differentiate between good and bad. These are the first signs of his conscience. The conscience is the highest part of his character, in which all spiritual and ethical lessons are stored and that were learned in former lives.
He developed this wisdom through all earlier experiences. Through education, this wisdom can gradually evolve. The young child gets to know its inner world. Parents and educators can help him with that. If his thinking faculty is completely developed, he will be able to deliberately make contact with his conscience. It is the foundation on which he himself will be able to build his ideal, the changes he wishes to see brought about in the world he lives in. But you will hear more on that tomorrow. Before we take a closer look at the most sensitive phase of the young child, the phase in which we can help to evolve his inner powers, we will first shortly repeat what the young child in fact is and what his inner powers are. When we talk about the young child, we talk about the nursery and toddler years. Those are the years before the child redevelops his own thinking powers, approximately around the seventh year. It is the phase in which the man starts to recognize himself and says I to himself. This is a gradual process, as he from an unconscious dream state as a baby becomes aware to be separated from his environment, after which the phase starts that he becomes self-consciousness. He sees a difference between himself and the other. This is an important moment for the educators, because the toddler starts to recognize his character, and we as educators can help him to uncover and awaken his true character, the reincarnating part. What then are these aspects of the reincarnating part that are present in the background? And which instruments will the young child develop to further express this reincarnating part? We already learned from Bauke that the ethnic aspect rooted through which the body, the instrument, could be formed. Next, Budi rooted the power of insight through which the emotional aspect developed. Insight and the emotional aspect are active in this stage, but the intellectual aspects hardly at all. This I recognized in a small boy, about 6 years old, that saw images on TV of a land in poverty. He saw that the people were hungry, and he was wondered how this could be. He decided to do something about it, and he made parcels of bread. And then he asked his mother if she could send him to the people. Of course, much more thinking power is needed to resolve the food shortage, but he followed his intuitive heart and he intervened. The intellectual aspect will start to work when his thinking power becomes active, and you will hear more about this tomorrow. We will list all the Buddhic characteristics of a young child for you, so you will be able to recognize them. Because when you want to stimulate them, you must of course first be able to recognize them. His fantasy and imagination. Everything is life, and we therefore see the young child talk to everything and take care of everything. Little insects, flowers, and even his toys. His altruism and empathy, wishing to serve others. At first, his own perception will be at the center, but later on, he will be able to identify with others. Power of judgment. He learns to see the difference between good and bad. And the why questions. They indicate that his exploration to his inner world has begun. He is confronted with all sorts of external phenomena, and he tries to find the inner cause of them. He follows his natural drive to unfurl himself. At this stage, it is vital for harmonious development that the Buddhic characteristics that must root are stimulated, so that the child can control the simultaneously developing emotional aspects, emotions and feelings. When the young child says I to itself, the reincarnating part starts to cooperate with the persona. The higher part of his character will be more suitable to come into the open when the persona is better fit for it. So from this moment, the struggle starts between the higher self and the lower self. It is a struggle between the I am me, that thinks it's separated from other life, and the I am one with the other, or I am part of everything and everyone. Then the young child realizes that he is an inseparable part of totality. The young child starts to further build his persona and develops at the same time his character. Now, which of the two, the I am me, or the altruistic reincarnating part, takes charge? We should be able to recognize this, for example, when a young child is playing with his toys and a friend joins him. Will it keep the toys to itself, or will it share the toys and will it play together with his friend? This is a chance for the educators to feed the altruistic forces. If the young child finds it difficult to share, we can guide him by talking about it and show him what the effect on his friend will be if he doesn't share his toys, but also what it means if he shares and they can play together. An ex-Point Loma student, Ingrid van Mater, once described how they were being taught, helping and sharing is what brotherhood means. In this phase, the young child will start to realize what is right and what is wrong. He will develop to the distinction between good and bad. It is possible that he wants to satisfy his own desires and wishes. Saying no and I want can sometimes be on the foreground, combined with the temper to get what he wants. This can sometimes end in real anger, tantrums or crying fits. But these are clumsy expressions of the persona, which can be apparent when the reincarnating part does not yet have the abilities to express itself. It is namely the reincarnating part that must control the persona, that is to say, master it. In this phase, we can guide the child to control his persona. And self-control does not mean that something has to be oppressed, for example by punishment, but to help the child to focus his consciousness on the reincarnating part. Or you have to offer the child other thoughts and stimulate him to think those thoughts.
If we react quietly and patiently to the toddler's anger, then the young child will be able to tune in to our mental atmosphere because he is still very sensitive to that. By doing so, he is able to regain his ease and self-control, and we can talk about it afterwards. These are also important lessons and opportunities for us educators, because most of us will surely recognize this phase is as a test to create patience. A good way to get the child into contact with his conscience during this period and to assist him to rebuild his character again is to tell universal fairy tales and stories in your own words, if you can, stories in which the difference between good and bad is being shown in order to let the child identify with the unselfish heroes. In doing this, we are stimulating the child's discernment. The child gets the opportunity to learn about itself, but to identify with others as well. A nice example of a child's identifying capability is this case of twins. When these children were still very young and one of them was crying, the one sister gave her favorite pet to comfort her. But some months later, when her capacity of identifying had been developed further on, she handed over not her own favorite pet of comfort, but the one of her sister. So, from the moment the young child speaks of I, the parents have the opportunity to help and assist the reincarnating part to come forward. Then the unselfish part of consciousness can take the lead from the selfishness of the personality. When the moment comes, the toddler attends school and friends, he will be able to develop his character further on. He is getting more independent and will be exploring, supervised by his parents, the outer world. His environment will become his field of education, his working place. One important factor at this point is our faith we have in the young child. By showing our interest is in his world and by allowing him to explore things is like a wake-up call to him. By exploring, he learns how to relate to his reincarnating part in order to follow his heart and be able to resist future temptations when he is getting older. During the Raja Yoga education of Catherine Tingley at Point Loma, the first three words being taught were attention, concentration, and perseverance. Quite rightly, one can be assured children can comprehend the meaning of all three words. Teaching the child to focus on his own reincarnating part will offer protection to all sorts of negative influences as well. He becomes less receptive. His attention is less focused on negative matters. We could stimulate this, for example, by viewing back in perspective at night before bedtime, in order to be taught our lessons of life. What happened today? What went well? And how can we do better? Draw conclusions together and investigate how to improve them by being an educator, be an example. We can start doing this when children are still very young, but in any case, stay close to the child's own scope of comprehension. The next morning, we recollect our good intentions again, by which the child will resound to his inner qualities, his reincarnating part, which will brighten his daytime period. If you do this on a regular basis, you will surely experience the most positive effects. Recalling all day's events before bedtime also leads to understanding the coherence between all events in a much wider sense. You learn to see the relation between cause and effect. We can deepen this by enlarging their world and discover life at a much larger range as well. We can visit a museum, or for instance go to the astronomical observatory, where you can teach the child that the universe is full of life, or by exploring nature together, in order to rediscover the many processes of life by glancing at a flower's beauty hidden within, its many existing colors, the honeybee picking up its nourishments, and the tiny little seed being planted, containing all capabilities in becoming a flower in its total splendor. But also cyclic life of the caterpillar, becoming a butterfly again as well, and so on and so on. The young child will be able to recall his very own insights gained in former lives. He will learn to tune in to his reincarnating part again. During this exploring and discoveries in the world around him, many why questions will rapidly occur. The young child's day are filled by it. Surely you will this will sound familiar to you. Why is it getting dark? Why do I have to go to bed? Why do the stars not fall from heaven? Or why must animals live outside when it rains? Parents sometimes wonder where these strange questions come from. There is a deeper meaning behind this occurrence. Why questions are the start of a search for a greater truth, a truth which is able to manifest itself out of the reincarnating part through the just proceeding thinking faculty. Asking Buddhic why questions means the child longs for understanding life. They arise from a natural urge wishing to learn more. This is a very energetic, but for the young child often not yet efficient. Yet it stimulates to get to know his inner world better. The why questions not only offer the possibility to get the child into contact with his reincarnating part, but also to get himself acquainted to his reincarnating part. That is the reason we ask you to consider these questions very seriously and cherish them. Often one short hint towards the child is enough to make him do his own further research. Sometimes ideas will disappear for a while in the child's mind, but will incarnate later on and new questions will spontaneously arise again. Always respond to them. Nothing is as bad as no response. But if you really can't find any answer, there's always the possibility of finding it out together. By offering arts, music, and all sorts of creativities, we are also stimulating the child to regain the contact with his reincarnating part. Educator and philosopher Loris Malaguchi, found children like true researchers and realized they only needed some extra help in order to give meaning to their new discoveries. He contracted artists in order to construct the children's ideas, thoughts and experiences. This way of thinking was copied by many schools and children daycare centers afterwards. This way of teaching suits very well to the young child's development. His imaginative faculty and memory are thus being trained. Parents and educators are thus able to help to accompany the child's character into the open. And as said before, the highest part of that character is its conscience. These are the ethical lessons learned in the past. When the young child has rediscovered its conscience, then this will be a nice leading up to the next phase in which he will regain his thinking faculty. Then he will be able to remember more consciously and independently the wisdom of his conscience and make proper use of it. Learning to love all that is alive is the key in which altruism and conscience are starting up. Each educator, and we all are, must be aware that there is a hero in each and every child, a hero who feels united with the world in which he lives and who prefers the well-being of his fellow men as well as the well-being of all life above all. A Raja Yoga educational vision offers the opportunity to gradually expand these qualities harmoniously into the open, in order to let it become a compassionate power in the world.
Dank u wel voor uw aandacht.
Goed.
Ladies and gentlemen, questions for Patricia. I have a question. Very often we are working during the day, and then we have a very little time and attention for our children. How can we, in this hectic style of living, do this education right, and then precisely create the right atmosphere? And in my feeling, it's a perfect atmosphere, but it takes time to create this atmosphere. And when you don't have the time, then you only have a couple of hours a day, and then you have to do all other things. So not only for the spiritual development of the children, but also the other things. So the combination of that, how do you do that? Can you comment on that? Well, what I can say is, what for myself is very important and which works, how busy we are, if we in the morning start tranquil and we start thinking what we want to do, then we resonate our inner quality, and then we lay a basis for the day and the way we go through that day. And children react on that basis. And if they go to a school or to a kindergarten, then it's very important to research where they go, and if you like the vision of these community centers or schools. And yes, busy we are. Yes, you have to plan, of course, and it's a big task for parents, and you have to try to set some priorities, to try to find the peace within ourselves, because if we find this peace, then this peace resonates in our children, and maybe in the evening, a moment to tell a fairy tale and to talk with the child, so not to a child, but talk with the child, and those are moments where you can reach the child, and where you can even if you're busy, you can do something. I don't know if that is an answer, maybe as a general remark. An ideal education is not only through the parents. parents. So when you look at the way it went in Port Loma, 7 days a week, 24 hours, it was done by educators. So there was a construction there, which did not say that the parents had to do everything. But it's just as Patricia says, if you have to find schools, then you have to look very critical if that is a good environment and a good atmosphere for your child. You know, I'm going to make a painful remark. Not every parent is perfect, and then it's sometimes it's better to hand it out to a real educator in schools. So Socrates so once said. If you have a young horse, are you going to train it yourself, or are you going to train it by a trainer? Well, no, everyone said no, of course, by a trainer. But that's a bit off the mark. So, yes, I was wondering, this image, this is an ideal image in a certain sphere, but in this society we don't live in this atmosphere. When you look at the newspapers and the television, it's always negative, so it's not not a very positive atmosphere. How do you learn a child to cope with that? Well, I think the most important is that you try to bring this atmosphere into the child gradually. You can't hold it back, of course, because they see TV and they read things. But you have to talk with to them about it. Don't think they're too little. Just talk with them and explain how things go. And for myself, it's a golden key. The idea of at the end of the day looking back together, and then you realize what the things are that the child takes with him and where he has problems with, and then you realize that you can talk together with him, and you look back, that comes out, and that's a good moment. That for the child to see the difference in atmosphere if he asks I don't understand it and what choice do I have to make, and then you can talk about it. So then you can talk about it really, really well. So that's for me a good point in the day. I can raise my child ideally, and then it comes into the society. In this society, there is no ideal. There is no ideals. So there are different things that are asked from the children than the ideals. What do you think about that? What we've tried to tell, if we try to focus the child on his higher part of his aspects, so he will focus on the higher parts. And he will see it from a certain compassion, and he will look at it with compassion, so he can place himself into the situation, and then the society is a challenge. It's a challenge to bring something in the society and to bring something of compassion in the society. And if we build ourselves a vision on this society, and then you can act from this vision, and then you know what the other needs to grow and to I hope I said it right. Well, you also said, and that is what I heard in the question. Do we have to make something, a course for the society? Or should we have should we change the society, or should we go? We think that is the best, that you try to change the society, so not adapt to the society, but try to change it. And and the hero is in everybody. So he's there. He has to be taken out, be awaken. What this sir just said, I would like to add, it's more not a question, but a life lesson which I learned with my eldest son. In the ideal sphere, we had a talking family. Everything could be talked about. Every question was answered, and then he goes to school, thinks that in school it's the same thing, that he can talk to teachers very honestly, and then you hear as a parent when he comes home, yes, but you say to the child, you have to, sometimes you do not ask questions. Oh, so Dana, now I have to lie. Yes, and then what do you do when there's too much difference between the school? You've learned him to talk and to find his own self, but the teacher doesn't want this. And especially in the education, and especially in secondary education, I saw it with both of my children, that there was another atmosphere, and that I find a pity. We try to create the best possible world for our children, and then it's bashed by others. Can I react on that? Yes, yes. Is it not that the yes. Is it not true that if you see this as a parent, that this happens with your child, which is not good for the education, that you try to that you talk to the school and that you talk to the teacher, and that you try to bring more of your atmosphere into the school? So I have to do something with the school and try to change it, but not try to find it in the child, but to try to change the school. And try to support the child in this change. I think we can agree on that. We don't live an ideal community, but we have to try to make it an ideal community. And you do not do that by accept this in a school, but you bring your child to a school, and then there is a certain atmosphere and a certain ethic, and the school needs to conform on that. I have I have dark children, colored children, yes. And I try to raise them in the right way, but they come into a very strange society, and they get bullied because the way they have because of their skin. And I try to explain there is no difference between the color of your skin, and I try to talk about this. But there is a group process in which they are discriminated because they are colored. But with me, they've learned to talk about it, and then they come into a situation where that's not possible. And I've tried to change the school, and I've tried to explain to the teachers what to do, but the teachers have their own program and they don't have time for these kind of things. So what I try to add, that it's difficult. So how do I? It's complicated, because it's completely opposite to our way of thinking. And you can have beautiful thoughts and understand and see everything, but in practice, you see that that it's a tough world out there. Yes, that is true. But the first thing that comes to mind, the first thing you talk to your child, and that is very good, and you give him self-confidence, and you learn to trust himself, and then he'll be more armed to live in this sometimes hard world. And the challenge is that he stays with his own roots, and that he does not try to change and to fit in. But that asks a lot of the child. Yes, that's true. It asks a lot of the child. Yeah. So she's making the same point, I think, that children are that they're discriminated sometimes. So, yeah. And to trust yourself, that is normally in a later age. So and maybe then they're already damaged. I personally don't think that is in a later stage. I think that we can learn them from a very young age, and that so. So and that creating that sphere is already very helpful to guard him. I think myself, it's not a simple problem, and it's not even a theosophical problem as an environmental problem, a problem of our society, where not all our colleagues think theosophically, but to have self-confidence. And to create a self-confidence is very important. Not very long ago, I spoke about this same issue. To talk about with some of our dark-colored persons in our society, and I asked him, how did you cope with this? And he said, well, the biggest problem is when I thought, well, I am and I have to work harder. But then I reached the conclusion I'm the same as everyone else, and then the problem was over. But he was an adult, so that was a more that is of course simpler. But it's always how do you react yourself? Do you stay close to yourself or not? You cannot solve all the problems, but 80% of the problems can be solved. I think with this attitude. If I go to a country where I am the only one white, then I also see that I'm different. Yes, another question. Ah. First of all, I want to say it. Yes, you have to make explicit what color. So don't say dark, because dark is always negative. So you have to pinpoint the color. So one of the solutions I found, I taught my children that they were not brown or dark, but they wanted to be recognized in their color. Yes, there are other people who are colored, and their teachers were colored, so they could identify with others, and that also helped to solve the problem. I also have two dark children, and they were not bullied for that, but sometimes they encountered less nice things in the environment. And what I tried to teach them was that they showed compassion for people who did not treat them nicely. So they tried to understand why they did not treat them nicely. So you can try to teach children to handle an environment which is not always nice. Yes, thank you. Yeah. Last question. At the workshop, I got some compliments that I came here in the 80s, and that at work I was confronted with discrimination about my talk. And then he went to the evening school. I went to the evening school, and and I talked better. And then I got complimented that I was very good in my talking. But you cannot citate me. Now I want to tell the whole story. We learned each other a long time ago, and then he came to our lectures, and he asked a lot of questions, but I did not understand him because he spoke very difficult. And then I heard him speaking better and better and better, and I could understand him much better. And now he listens very easy to his questions, and now I can answer them very easily. So that's the compliment.
Okay, dames en heren.
Well, thank you, Patricia. I think now we're going to start with the workshops.
En dat wij even met elkaar afspreken.